Here we are, Lord, at your calling. We are gathered here around this district and around the world to celebrate today. On behalf of Bishop Park, the Cabinet, the Susquehanna Annual Conference, the York District, we welcome you for joining us today for the installation of Kathy Boileau as the new District Superintendent of the York District. We are so pleased to be able to join together today in prayer for Kathy as she starts this new journey and continues this journey, but also to celebrate what God has been doing through leadership in the past, confident that God will continue to provide that leadership through Kathy and many others, and lead us and guide us into the future. We celebrate this day. As a word of instructions for those of you online, if for whatever reason you have difficulty with your connection, we have multiple platforms in which we live stream. So if you get disconnected for whatever reason, we do broadcast on YouTube, Facebook, and Church Online. Now, that may be all hard to get to, except if you go to our website, BethanyRedLion.com. There you can find live stream instructions and get reconnected on a different platform if you need to. Again, welcome to today's service. May we continue our worship with our call to worship.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Josh Wargo. I am the pastor at Chapel Church in Red Lion. The Lord is doing a new thing. 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 We want to be a part of it. Praise God, the Lord is doing a new thing. And wherever you are joining us from, we invite you to join together in the hymn, Spirit of God, Bright Wind, and that is found in the Faith We Sing, number 2117.
Begin, close as you always do, create us anew, give us the breath to sing, lifted on soaring wing, held in your hands, born of your wings. Alleluia, come Spirit, come. Alleluia, come Spirit, come. Spirit of God, bright dove, grant us your peace and love. Healing upon your wings for all living things. For when we live in peace, captives will find release, held in your hands, borne on your wings. Alleluia, come Spirit, come. Alleluia. Come, Spirit, come. Spirit of God in all, we gladly hear your call. A life that sings the power of your wings. Born of your grace, we rise, shining in your eyes, held in your hands, born on your wings. Alleluia. Come, Spirit, come. Alleluia. Come, Spirit.
Good afternoon. My name is Larry Spear, and I am the lay leader at Gettysburg United Methodist Church. Let us come to the Lord in prayer. Almighty and most gracious God, we worship and praise your holy name. We come into your presence today with joy and thanksgiving to celebrate the installation of Reverend Catherine Boileau as our new York District Superintendent. Bless her with the power of your Holy Spirit to lead your churches of the York District in ministry and service to your people. Give her strength and wisdom as she supervises and supports the church's life. Let the Holy Spirit flow through us, the clergy and laity of this district, as we follow her leadership to navigate these challenging times while we seek to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. Be with us and inspire us to be brave and willing to do a new thing according to your will for us. We ask all these things in the name of your most precious Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Redeemer. Amen.
Praise the Lord, O my soul, all my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all the oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far as he removed our transgressions from us. This is the word of the Lord.
Good afternoon. I am Jonah Boileau, son of Kathy Boileau, our new district superintendent. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those he predestined, he also called. Those he called, he also justified. Those he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say in response to this? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Thank you.
Grace to you in the name of Jesus Christ, Prince of Peace, healer of our brokenness, and hope of the world. We are gathered today in celebration of the installation of Reverend Catherine Erskine Boileau as the superintendent of York District of the Susquehanna Annual Conference. My thanks go to many who worked together to make today's celebration possible, including the pastors, staff, and the congregation of the hosting church, the district superintendency committee, and those who are participating in this installation service, and others. I have frequently said that the district superintendent has the most demanding ministry that any elder is asked to do. The district superintendent is an extension of the office of bishop, and shall oversee the total ministry of the clergy and of the churches of the district in their missions of witness and service in their communities and the world. Within the Susquehanna Annual Conference, the scope of superintending is big. Each superintendent has somewhere around 115 churches and a large number of clergy to supervise. It is their role to assure that the needs of these churches and the communities are connected with the gifts and graces of the clergy, while keeping in mind the total missional vision and the needs of the conference. I am so thankful for Reverend Catherine Boileau's positive response to the call to serve the office of the district superintendency, and am honored to introduce and install Reverend Boileau as the York District Superintendent. Catherine grew up in a United Methodist Church family with both parents active at the local church and the conference level in the Eastern Pennsylvania Conference. During her college days, Catherine's spiritual formation developed into a powerful passion for mission and social justice that still comprises the core of her very being. It was at First United Methodist Church, Lewistown, where Catherine was called into ministry when she was inspired by the preaching of one of our most powerful conference preaching legends, Reverend Don Ciampa. Like many of our pastors, Catherine had a journey which took her through church camps. From 1987 to 89, she was the director and program manager of camps and conferences of the then Southern New Jersey Annual Conference, where she directed residential camps for at-risk urban children, including Camden, Trenton, and Atlantic City. Her pastoral journey also began in New Jersey. She was the associate pastor at Salem United Methodist Church in Pleasantville, New Jersey. There, she helped to launch Pleasantville Community Tutoring Initiative. She was part of a three-person pastoral staff which chartered the first Spanish-speaking Protestant congregation in the Atlantic City area. Upon her return to Pennsylvania, Catherine began her itinerant journey in the former Central Pennsylvania and the Susquehanna Annual Conferences with pastorates beginning in 1994. She served as a pastor at Mount Olivet, Mount Nebo United Methodist Church in Delta, associate pastor at Bethany United Methodist Church, Red Lion, pastor at New Creation Community United Methodist Church, Dover, and recently, from 2014 to 2020, lead pastor of the First United Methodist Church in Chambersburg. While there, she led the congregation to a powerful new vision which connects the church to the critical needs of the people in the community through ministries like Grief Share, Stevens Ministries, and Oxygen, which is a supportive community for family members of those struggling with addiction. She studied English as a second language and general education development classes in the Chambersburg community. While there, Catherine has been a founding board member of the first two licensed recovery houses in Franklin County, providing a safe and faith-inviting community in which people exiting rehab could rebuild lives, families, and acquire tools to overcome addiction in a Christ-centered community. Catherine has always had a heart for mission as she traveled globally and nationally for mission to Guatemala, Haiti, Puerto Rico, Mexico, and San Francisco. Her mission involvement has brought her some of her greatest joy. As a gifted pastor, Catherine is well respected. She has published sermons in the Abingdon Woman's Preaching Commentary, as well as has been one of the co-deans for the Susquehanna Conference Licensing School. Our local pastors have expressed their deep appreciation for the excellent licensing school experience. Catherine is also a gifted musician. She was one of the pioneers in developing contemporary and praise worship in our conference. Catherine has a BA degree in English literature and graduated summa cum laude, Bowdoin College. She completed her seminary training at Eastern Baptist Theological Seminary, now Palmer Seminary. She has also studied at the Bryn Mawr Conservatory of Music and Fuller Theological Seminary. Catherine has been married to Mike Boileau for 31 years. Mike is a computer scientist at the FAA, where he has worked for 31 years and has won several national awards for his work. Together, they have two sons, Samuel and Jonah. Your support, prayers, and care for Catherine and her family, and your partnership in ministry with your district superintendent would be deeply appreciated. Please welcome Reverend Catherine Erskine Boileau, our York District Superintendent.
Servant, let me be as Christ to you. Pray that I might have the grace to let you be my servant too.
Catherine, you have been appointed to be among us for the ministry of word and sacrament and called to a special ministry of supervision and leadership. You are called to guard the faith, to seek the unity, and to exercise the discipline of the church, and to supervise and support the church's life, work, and mission. Do you affirm your commitment to this ministry in our midst?
Bishop, I affirm my commitment to these ministries in your midst.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, as a people committed to participate in the ministries of the church, by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness, will you support and uphold Catherine in these ministries? We celebrate your appointment to your district. We affirm your leadership. Pledge to you of support in our mutual ministry in the name of Jesus. Amen.
We are pilgrims on a journey. We are brothers on the road. We are here to help each other walk the mile and bear the load.
Catherine, take this Bible and be among us as the one who proclaims the word for the edification of believers and the conversion of the world. Amen.
Catherine, take this water, be renewed in your baptism, and renew us in ours.
Catherine, take this bread and cup, and keep us in communion with Christ and his church.
Catherine, take this hymnal and book of worship to guide us in our prayer and praise.
Catherine, take this towel and basin and be as one of us who serves.
Amen.
Catherine, take this stole and be among us as a pastor. This stole has on the children of the world, which I know are dear to your heart.
Catherine, take this book of discipline and use it to strengthen our connections as United Methodists. Amen.
Amen.
Catherine, take this globe and lead us in our mission to all the world.
I forgot to announce myself earlier as we did our introductions. I'm Pastor Ron Doerspike, pastor here at Bethany Church. May we be in prayer now for Catherine. Will you pray with me? Oh God, you call us in many different ways at different times in our lives. We have seen your Holy Spirit work upon, within, and around Catherine as she ministered to so many. And as she continues to minister in this new way, we know that your Holy Spirit will continue to lead and guide her, that she will be among us as a pastor, that she will be among us as a leader. We have seen those gifts in the past, and we trust that you will be able to use those gifts well in the future, as she is the district superintendent of the York District. We know, O Lord, that she cannot do this ministry alone. First and foremost, she will need you. And I know that she seeks you daily in prayer. Undergird her, Lord. Strengthen her. Continue to give her the wisdom that she will need. And by your hand, lead and guide her and us as we come into ministry together. For we know, O Lord, that yes, it's not alone. She needs you, but we need one another. And so my prayer is, O Lord, that you will surround Catherine, yes, with your Holy Spirit, but you will surround her with the people she needs for this ministry. People who can help uphold her and support her. People who can give advice and some wisdom. People who just have a shoulder to cry on at times. Or a listening ear for all the frustration that may come. Lord, work through all of us. This isn't up to Catherine alone. It's not up to any of us alone. But it is together. Your Holy Spirit leading and guiding, yes, through Catherine, but also through us. In this York District, in the Susquehanna Conference of the United Methodist Church, and believers all over the world, you work through us. I now pray for Catherine's family, because they are entering into this journey with her. Ask you to support them, protect them, guide them. Help them to be that family of love which you have created to support one another as she enters this new phase of ministry. Lord, we trust in you, and we know that you will continue to work in and through her life. This is our prayer this day. Give her the strength, give her the boldness to be who you call her to be. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I'm grateful for your presence. For those of you who are here, thank you. We had hoped this place would be full with the York District, but I know through the many texts and messages, there are many with us today, and I say thank you to you as well. The gospel is not just for us inside the church, and not just for one nation, and dear to my heart, and perhaps some of the most powerful worship services that I've been a part of have been those which have happened in more than one language, sometimes simultaneously. As we know as this afternoon, sometimes the communication is a challenge, but the Spirit that comes at Pentecost and speaks the gospel to multiple nations is one of the most powerful expressions of who we are in Christ. And so, Pastor Janir Liscus, will you come up? We know this afternoon we have friends in Haiti, some who have come up with us, and Pastor Janir is a ordained pastor in the United Brethren Church and a dear friend and a partner in ministry with whom we've created a mission in Haiti. And so some of those times in Haiti, but also here in Pennsylvania, we've enjoyed preaching together. We're not going to do that today, but so our friends who are here and around the globe can understand the gospel. He'll be translating for me. We good?
Yes, I'm
We're good. Good. Okay. So from John chapter 5, after these things, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there in Jerusalem, by the sheep gate, a pool, which is called in Hebrew,
Bethsaida,
having five porticos. In these lay a multitude of those who were sick, blind, lame, and withered. And a certain man was there who had been there 38 years in his sickness. When Jesus saw him lying there, and knew that he had already been a long time in that condition, he said to him, do you wish to get well? The sick man answered him, sir, I have no one to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up. But while I'm coming, another steps down before me. Jesus said to him, arise, take up your pallet and walk. And immediately, the man became well and took up his pallet and began to walk. Now it was the Sabbath on that day. Therefore, the Jews were saying to him, the one who was cured, it is the Sabbath, and it's not permissible for you to carry your pallet. But he answered them, he who made me well was the one who said to me, take up your pallet and walk. And they asked him, who is this man who said to you, take up your pallet and walk? But he who was healed did not know who it was, for Jesus had slipped away while there was a crowd in that place. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Merci, Zami Mwa.
Thank you.
Today we can't take an offering physically, but when we are blessed and we have received a blessing, love flows best when it flows in and out and through us. Like a pool that gets stagnant when we hold on to the blessings, so it is that we have the opportunity to go and to do good for others. Being part of a multicultural church, which we are, in this time of division in our country, and even that can seep into our local churches, one of the most powerful things Jesus tells us is that when we walk in love with one another, by our relationships with one another, by our love demonstrated for one another, is how the world will come to know Christ. They may have things that bring meaning. They may have things in which they do good works. But the love of Christ can only be demonstrated through us. And that love has to transcend those cultural, racial, political boundaries. One of the ministries that seem there beneath our nose that perhaps we haven't noticed as much of how revolutionary it is our Susquehanna camp and retreat ministries. There at the campfire, if not the communion table, although sometimes it seeps over to communion, at the campfire, as our children and youth gather, and adults, we find that at the campfire, everybody looks beautiful. At the campfire, it has that lighting which is gentle and makes us look, all our blemishes seem to fade, and we look beautiful to one another. At the campfire, we're not arguing about politics. We're not dividing. But we're gathered together in the sense of community, a sense of storytelling, transparency, and love. And so this year, through COVID, our ministries of camp and retreats, I'm not saying it right, am I, Kevin? The camps and retreats, Kevin, who was up earlier, is the director of that. And during COVID, our camps, camping and retreat ministries have fallen on difficult times. Obviously, we were not able to be at the campfire with one another. But those ministries are vital. One, because they are a most effective tool to reach the children and youth in the upcoming generations. Generation after generation, time after time, children and youth who have an opportunity to go away from their setting and to be at camp, experience Jesus Christ. Many of our pastors will say that it was at the campfire or through camping in this conference that they received a call to ministry. I know one of my own sons, through Camp Penn, made a commitment to Christ. But the other part is this. At the campfire, through the camps and retreats, when we experience koinonia Christ together, when we share him together, we become that community that Scripture talks about. And so York District especially, but if you are listening around the globe and want to give to the offering, I will gladly receive your check. But York District, we want to take on the challenge that we will raise at least $5,000 for the camp and retreat. Starting tomorrow, there will be a video of Kevin Witt on our district webpage. We thought it might be cumbersome to try to take an offering today, but the link for how you can give or send your check into the district office, so we might do it en masse, it will be available first thing in the morning. The other part of this is that Kevin has given a challenge that if we have 50 persons who will commit, not necessarily to give 500 on their own, but to raise 500, the gap between what is needed has now and what is needed by the year's end will be met. So I don't want to be competitive, Judy Walker, but I think York District could go above and beyond 5,000. And surely there's got to be at least 15 of us that could raise 500 or find friends who could raise 500. I know you are creative and you are generous, but let's invest in the next generation. Let's invest and demonstrate that we are more than a broken and isolated society. Let's pour in and be revolutionary so that we can gather around the campfire again in our camps and retreats ministry. Stay strong. So as you reflect, I invite you to take your place at the table with us this day, spiritually over the internet, but also in prayer. And for the offertory, Kelly and Dan are going to present a hymn called Place at the Table.
Everyone born a place at the table, for everyone born clean water and bread, a shelter, a space, a safe place for growing, for everyone born a star overhead. And God will delight when we are creators of justice and joy. Yes, God will delight when we are creators of justice, justice and joy. For woman and man, a place at the table, revising the roles, deciding the share, with wisdom and grace, dividing the power, for woman and man, a system that's fair, for young and for old, a place at the table, a voice to be heard, a part in the song. The hands of a child in hands that are wrinkled, young and for old, the right to belong. And God will delight when we are creators of justice and joy. Yes, God will delight when we are creators of justice, justice and joy. Just and unjust, a place at the table, abuser abused, the need to forgive. In anger, in hurt, a mindset of mercy, for just and unjust, a new way to live. For everyone born, a place at the table, to live without fear, and simply to be, to work, to speak out, to witness and worship, for everyone born the right to be free. And God will delight when we are creators of justice and joy. Yes, God will delight when we are creators of justice, justice and joy.
I want to be sure, I haven't pulled my mic. Are we okay, Janelle, on this mic? In the kind, kind introduction that Bishop Park read, no one accused me of being overly technological savvy, and I just wanted to make sure. It is good to be with you, and I appreciate so much your presence, not just in this moment, but on this journey. To our dear Bishop, who has chosen to stay beyond retirement with us, I am so grateful that you're still on this journey with us. For the other members of cabinet who have been entirely gracious in our first couple months of learnings, for the superintendency committee who has been in this journey since the night of our introduction, to our family and to our friends, thank you. This is a place of Ebenezer for me. Thus far, God has brought me safely. I had the blessing of serving Bethany Church. And right down there on the altar was a moment that I had that was much like we read about in the Gospels. For when I came to Bethany, I did not come in the usual way. I was not appointed, although I was introduced by a district superintendent. And the reason was because I had a severe illness and I was on disability. Broken in body and with a doctor who was so wonderful and compassionate, who said, "No one who has been as sick as you are in this illness has ever come back to be full time." Bethany embraced me and knew that I would not be full strength. And so, like the man in the gospel, as I gaze at that point on the altar rail there, I knew what it was to be sick and broken. I knew what it was to have no hope in human beings being able to solve my problem. And like the man, I knew what it was on that spot for Jesus to visit me and miraculously start the journey of healing. The one difference I had, though, that I had, that the man didn't have in the story, who lay by the pool for 38 years, imagine, 38 years without hope, was I had a circle of friends, the body of Christ, who surrounded me and did not abandon me. Initially, when I became ill, I had a colleague named Mike Druck, who said, "I can't fast from everything for months, but I will fast from chocolate until you gain your strength back." I had a district superintendent named Roger Menser, who battled in prayer and refused to accept that I would not be back into full-time ministry someday. I had a lead pastor, perhaps you've met him, named Charlie Salisbury, who knew and said, "All I need from you," when I would cry on the phone and say, "I'm exhausted, I'm in bed for 2 days because I preached another sermon," who would say, "Boileau," because he's never used my first name, "Boileau, all I need from you, what you think and say in 5 minutes about vision is all I need from you." I had a people here at Bethany who prayed for me. And one night at a healing service, because I believe that God has the power to heal, after we had prayed for everybody else, the loving kindness of the saints of Bethany laid hands and also prayed for me. My healing took a long time, but it started in that moment. And as I think back on that Ebenezer here, in this moment in my journey, I was never alone. Just as Jesus visited this man, so Jesus, and here's my testimony, Jesus visited me. And just as Michelle beautifully read, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget none of his blessings, who heals our illnesses and forgives our sins." Thank you, Michelle. That Jesus came to visit me. But he also came in the fullness of the church which surrounded me. So unlike this man, I was never alone. For the body of Christ was around me. And in this moment, I am not alone. Jesus, as we read this gospel, Jesus, there's no explanation of why Jesus would pick this man out to be healed. I love this healing story because it is clear it's not because of the stellar faith of this man. In fact, quite the opposite. He's kind of difficult to love. Maybe he was lovable at the beginning and maybe not, but after 38 years, he's gotten that sense of bitterness and abandonment.
Nobody comes. Nobody's there. Oh, if only. Jesus says, do you want to get well? And this man just turns it on. Well, every once in a while an angel comes and stirs up the pool, and I can't get there. He doesn't even answer Jesus' question. It's not stellar faith. And going down in the text, even after he's healed, and they say, who healed you? He says, I don't know. This isn't the Samaritan woman running around and saying, this is unbelievable. This Jesus is amazing. This isn't the Syrophoenician woman who says, even the crumbs under your table would be enough. Or the centurion says, just at one word, my servant will be healed. This isn't even Mary and Martha wrestling in faith and saying, I know in the end of things, Lord, there will be a resurrection. This guy has nothing. And his temperament is kind of difficult to approach. But Jesus picks him out at the pool. It's he that Jesus focuses on and reminds me of grace. That Jesus didn't pick him out because he was so lovable, but because Jesus is so loving. It wasn't because the man earned Jesus' favor with the right prayers and the right faith. It's because God is a God of compassion who is steadfast in his love, looks beyond our selfishness and our ways of getting tied up and our brokenness, looks beyond our grumpy days or the days we exhibit nothing, and Jesus loves us nonetheless. He didn't heal me because I was so deserving or because I did things better than anyone else. He didn't call me to ministry. Here's a fact. He didn't call me into ministry. Well, certainly not this present call, because I'm brighter, more faithful, more holy than anyone else. It's just because that's what he does. He loves us because he's a God of love. And when everybody else abandons us, Jesus never does. I want to say to those of you who might be watching, maybe your football team is going bad right now and somehow you stumbled into this service, or maybe you're a friend connected to the Boileau family that might not necessarily be attached to a church. I just want to say this to you. If everyone else has abandoned you, Jesus still will show up for you. He doesn't wait till your life gets together or you're overcome the addiction or that you even figure things out. Jesus shows up for you, just as you are. If I have one prayer for us as we start this journey together, York District, it would be for that we would have the eyes of Jesus. And we would really see people. When Jesus sees him, it changes everything. Do you know what it is to be really seen? We are so good in this culture, and it's seeped, unfortunately, into the church at seeing the label or the lifestyle or the category or the race, and categorizing groups of people and not really seeing the one in front of us. Oh, church, if there was ever a way we could witness to the incredible compassion of our God, surely it would be to look at every person and at least see them. In my journey and my former ministry, I had a friendship with a man I'll call Danny. Danny had been coming into our ministry for quite a while and stayed at the back. And when I'd invite people to stay for prayer, he would stay, but he'd never come forward. And I respected his space. Until one day, furious with me, he said, I stayed, and you didn't pray for me. After dinner, the story started to come out of him, and we stayed, and he was full of rage and tears, and then broke down and cried and said, I don't know why I'm crying. This is the first time in so many years. But he was telling me his story and all the wounds of life that he endured. He said, I walk on the street and nobody looks at me. So the next week at Sheets, Mike and I were there and I ran in and there he was. And in my somewhat over-exuberant personality that sometimes cannot be a blessing, I called out his name out loud and ran to him, and Sheets was crowded and everybody stopped to see this scene. So I talked to him and then I went out and I said to my husband, oh my gosh, I'll never see him again. Next week he was there early, tapping me on the shoulder and ducking around, teasing me. We started on a friendship together. I'd like to tell you it was perfect and all his problems became whole and all my problems became whole. I realized sometimes that what I wanted to push him into was not his lifestyle. But if Danny didn't teach me anything else, he taught me the power of simply seeing someone can have on a life. York District, let's pray for the eyes to see people, to see them as Jesus sees them. But that's not the only prayer. The flip side of that is the man who's lying by the pool. And he's got a visual problem as well. And here's what it is. Jesus, the Lord of life, the Niagara Falls of living water, is standing in his midst and says, do you want to be healed? And the man is so busy looking at the pool for healing, for an angel to maybe come and stir things up like happened one time, that he misses the reality of the God who is standing before him, the God who created heaven and earth. The God who formed him and made him as he is, gave him gifts and graces. The God who put the stars in, on their course and the sun and the moon. The God who made the seas. The God who was going to heal him because he was on his way to a cross to die for his sins and his healing. The God who is for us, as Jonah read, and not against us. But his eyes were on the pool. Oh, if only some angel would come, someone would carry me. How small the problem was, his sight was missing, his God was too small. That as if God can only heal the first one into the pool, as if he runs out of compassion or power. His God was too small, as if only in this way and once in a while would he bless his people, as if he doesn't bless us every day, as Psalm 103 proclaims. And as Jonah read, if God is for us, who can be against us? Church, perhaps have we made in this coronavirus God too small? Have we limited him to the pool? God can only move if we don't wear masks, or if we're meeting together in one place. If we have Easter together, we have to have the trumpets, or Easter will not come. I remember when we did it this way, if only the angel would come and visit us. Hebrews says this, O church. God has sent us someone so much more than a mere angel. God sends us angels and blessings that happen in our way, and we can't explain why. Just as I can't explain why my healing came that night on that spot. Those blessings come once in a while, but Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He doesn't need an angel, and he doesn't need a pool, because his word spoke and the universe came out. So when Jesus speaks, we are made whole. When Jesus speaks, the man's sins are forgiven, and his body receives new life. Oh, York District, let's pray for eyes to really see each person in our path for who they are. Perhaps they're voting, dare I say, for a different candidate than you. Perhaps they are from a different cultural or ethnic group. Perhaps they disagree with you about the theology of the church. But Let's pray for eyes to see each one as God sees them. And let's take our eyes off the pool. It is true, God moved through our churches in magnificent ways. Those miracles were real that God already did in our churches. But I will not limit my God, the Alpha and the Omega, that he has to work in the same way that he always did, because his mercies are new every morning. I will not limit him that we have to wait that he can only fall on this church or that church. If we work and struggle to do it just this way, then God will come again and revisit. God is already here. He promises where two or more are gathered, he is in our midst. God is bigger than Corona. Jesus Christ is the same. And what Scripture says is this: let's not limit God. If God is for us, then what does it matter what's against us? If God is for us, then Corona is an obstacle and a circumstance that God can overcome and can create new ways and new pathways of ministry. If God is for us, then let's not watch too much at the pool, waiting for an angel to come. But let's take our eyes off the pool and onto Jesus, the one who was, the one who is. If God did not hold back his son, but gave him up for all of us, then how much more will he not give us all good things? And maybe we'll hear Jesus say to us, "Do you want to get well, church? Take up your pallet and walk. Take up your cross and follow me. I am not limited. I am doing all things new. And here's the promise that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities, not things past, present, or future, there is nothing that can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." York District. Let's pick up our pallets and walk. Let's rock the next chapter. God is already in our midst. He is with us and not against us. Amen and amen. So I invite you now to be in prayer with me. Pastor Janier, would you come up and do a short prayer in Creole, and I'll do in English, and then what we're going to invite you to do is to pray with us the Lord's Prayer. But I invite you to pray the Lord's Prayer in whatever is your first language, or whatever language you're practicing lately. But I invite you to pray in whatever tongue God leads you to pray. But let us, I'm going to have you pray maybe just a minute for the church in the York District. And then you pray in Creole, and then I'll pray in English.
Papa qui dans ciel là dans le nom de Jésus-Christ. Nous bénissons et nous demandons au nom du sang versé à la croix, grâce descend sur l'église ça et côté dans district ça, côté famille ça yo, réunis pour recevoir pasteur Cathy pour diriger congrégation ça. Ma demande dans le nom de Jésus-Christ, que grâce, que pouvoir ciel là, couvre l'église, pour mettez-nous ensemble, et ben nous y est, pour nous voir chaque monde, même Jean Jésus-Christ, ouais, nous prions dans le nom de Jésus-Christ, qui vit, qui règne, au siècle des siècles. Amen.
Lord, as we join on this new chapter, we thank you for the leadership of our bishop. We pray your blessing upon him.
We pray for those who are called to lead in various ways. Some of us called to lead districts, and some of us called to lead other ministries of the conference. Some of us are called to lead as pastors, some of us as lay leaders. Some of us are staff parish chairs and trustees, Sunday school teachers. Lord, you called all of us, not just district superintendents. So pour out your spirit on the York District and our beautiful conference. Pour out your spirit in such a way you open the eyes to the reality of the promises of your word, because you can never fail. Pour out your spirit, O God, that we have eyes of compassion, that we can truly look, listen, and enter into someone else's world. Take away the judgments and the biases, the opinions that so often block our fellowship. And help us, O God, to take our eyes off the pool that was. We thank you for the past miracles, for they are precious and blessed. And we saw signs of your moving. But we have grace only for the moment we're living in. So give us grace for this hour and to live all future hours, keeping our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. And we pray, O God, as the Church of Jesus Christ, blessed with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms and here on earth, we pray, O God, in the Spirit, in the words that you taught us to pray, and using the words trespasses, I invite you to pray in your first tongue, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Before I give the blessing, again, I want to extend my gratitude and for your presence and a prayer that you will know, if nothing else from this day, you will know that God is for you and not against you. You will know that he showed up at the pool that day because he had compassion on one who didn't deserve it, and that you will know he will have compassion on you. Not because you deserve it, but because he is love. May you know him in your coming and your going and your rising and your laying down. May you know him in the body of Christ, which is the fullness of him on earth. And may you know him in the joy of seeing him work, not just once in a while through an angel, but every day of your life. And for the benediction this day, we are going to invite you, those who are in house, to remain seated. I know it's going to be hard, but we're refraining from singing. But those of you at home, you can sing so the neighbors hear it, and the people down the street hear it, and maybe even we hear it. But our final blessing today comes from the Bethany praise team. And so I invite you to worship, and then at the end of that, we invite you to depart. It's called the blessing.
Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
For you, he is for you.